Coming up with the impending end of support for Windows 7, if you still need help with your Windows 7 to Windows 10 migration, we're going to walk through the services for app remediation and upgrade automation using FastTrack to help get your environment to Windows 10, whether you're fully on-premises or using the cloud. I'm joined today by Aleks Lopez, who leads the desktop app assure team from FastTrack and Microsoft. Welcome.
Thanks for having me on the show, Jeremy.
All right, so everyone knows that the end of support for Windows 7 is coming around the corner in January. So if you're using Windows 7 and you haven't started planning your deployment to Windows 10, maybe you're concerned about the effort involved and have been stalling, it's really not too late. The good news is we can help.
That's right. We have a couple of services that we've developed in response to customer feedback. So we've talked with hundreds of customers over the last couple of years, and really the main concern that keeps coming up is application compatibility. So customers, especially those who experience the Windows XP to Windows 7 migrations, they really think that their business critical applications aren't going to work. And rest assured, the application experience on Windows 10 is much different than it was when we were moving to Windows 7. The other common concern that comes up is that customers think they have to have all these cloud-connected services in order to deploy Windows 10.
Right.
And that's not true either. But those things together can make the deployment seem really daunting.
Right. And let's start, though, with app compatibility, because there's a lot that's changed there. So why don't we talk about what's changed and what we're seeing in terms of all of our work that we've been doing with these organizations that have started deploying Windows 10.
Yeah, I mean, the biggest thing, I always start with this, is that Windows 10 and Office 365 have been built with compatibility in mind. So in the past, we've only had app compat signals that told us that more than 99% of applications that worked on Windows 7 also work on Windows 10. But in the last year, we've worked with hundreds of organizations through this new service that we'll talk about called Desktop App Assure. And we've evaluated over 255,000 applications and found that only 402 of those needed remediation assistance. That's 0.16%. It's really an incredibly low percentage of compatibility failures.
All right. So what about that tiny, tiny 0.16% that actually do need some fixing?
Well, that's the fear. Even though 0.16% is a very small percentage, if you have a business critical application in that 0.16%, that can be incredibly stressful and really expensive for your organization to remediate. So for that reason, we built Desktop App Assure. App Assure is a no-cost service. It's included in, as part of your license. And what we do is we work directly with customers in a support-like model. So we work to troubleshoot and root cause an application issue, and then we determine how to fix it. So if it's an issue with Windows or one of our products like Office, we're committed to fixing those bugs directly in the product itself or in our operating system. Mm-hmm. In some cases, we actually find that it's an issue in a third-party application. So we reach out to that third-party vendor and we work directly with them to help them fix the app. Or sometimes we find that the issue is in the customer's line of business application. And so we partner with the customer to fix that as well. If we have access to source code, we might make recommendations on how to fix that code. Or in other cases, we apply one of the many mitigations we have available to us.
So is this service then something that's available globally?
Yes, so we're available in all time zones and we support 10 different languages, so we can help a number of our customers around the world. The big thing that we're trying to achieve here and our biggest goal is to make sure we leave you in a better state after you've worked with our team. So we want to make sure that we make our customers' apps future-proof, make sure they're resilient to future Windows and Office updates. And then wherever we can, we want to make them more secure as well. We don't want you to have to compromise any security settings in your environment to get an application to run.
Okay, so if I found an issue then with maybe an app in my environment, how would I engage?
It's a great question. So many of you have maybe worked with Microsoft support before or with support in another organization. So you may be used to creating a single ticket for every problem you might have. Our team's a little bit different. So basically you submit a single request for assistance through our portal. And after that, we handle all that ticketing on your behalf, essentially. It doesn't matter how many months we work with you or how many application issues you might bring us, we take care of that on the back end.
So it's just one request?
One single request. So let me show you what that looks like.
Okay.
So if you're trying to access our portal to submit a request for assistance, you just go to aka.ms/desktop-app-assure-request, and then I'll show you what that process looks like.
Okay.
The login process is through Azure Active Directory. And so once you come in, it's really a three-step process from there. So the first page takes you through our service description that helps you understand what's in and out of scope and the qualification criteria. And then we ask some basic information about your company. We want to understand who the primary contact is at the organization in case it's not the person that's submitting the request. And then we would like to understand some of the things around the number of devices that you have, the number of applications, the number needing assistance, and then a brief summary of the problem that you have. And then once you hit submit here, it'll take you to this confirmation page. At this point is when our team has received this request for assistance, and we'll reach out to the requester within 24 business hours. Now, I mentioned earlier that you don't have to have a bunch of cloud-connected services in order to deploy Windows 10, but then I said that you needed Azure Active Directory in order to log into this portal. So if you don't yet have Azure AD set up in your environment, that's no problem. Please just email my team at achelp@microsoft.com, and we'll help you get started.
All right, so why don't we focus on the work that your team's doing in terms of application compatibility. For that tiny 0.16% of apps that might be affected, then how does your team actually step in and start working with customers that contact you?
Yeah, the first line of defense is actually always a quick online search. So what we often find is that there may already be a known fix available for a particular issue, especially if it's a third-party application and the customer just needs to install that to fix the issue. Or maybe there's an upgraded app available that's supported on Windows 10. This actually happened quite frequently in our program that we had Chris Jackson write a blog on this topic to help our customers out.
Right. So can you then walk us through a case of maybe a line of business app that comes in that didn't have information online? I've tried to search it via Google or via Bing, and you have to actually build a fix for it. What does that process look like?
Yeah, so I mentioned that Windows 10 has been built for compatibility, and one of the ways we do that really is by having a compat infrastructure directly in Windows. So let me actually walk through and show you what that looks like. What you're looking at is something called Compatibility Administrator, and Compat Admin is part of the app compatibility tools that's part of the Windows Assessment and Deployment Toolkit.
Right.
And the way that to really think about this is a set of pre-built application fixes for the most common issues that we see around compatibility. And then in many cases, you can actually see 6,000, almost 6,000 here. We actually target those compatibility fixes to some known applications that we have in the ecosystem. Mm-hmm. And so I'll show you an example of that here using 3DMark. So here you can see 3DMark is an application vendor, and then you see a number of EXEs which represent applications for this vendor. We've targeted with a number of compatibility fixes, and then we also have these matching files that essentially tell us which specific EXE to target that fix to. Now, if I actually collapse the folder here, the directory, you'll also be able to see that we have a directory for compatibility fixes and compatibility modes. Now, compatibility fixes are essentially fixes for specific compatibility problems. And we end up grouping some of those that are common into these compatibility modes for specific scenarios. There are over 400 compatibility fixes and 100 compatibility modes in Compat Admin.
Okay,
so now I'm gonna cut over to this real life example from one of our customers. In this particular case, our customer had an application that was built for XP, and it was driving a peripheral that was attached to a phone system. And so when I launch this, you'll actually see the issue that's occurring. First, the application's actually gonna try to access a backend database that we don't have on this device. So I'm gonna click through this prompt here, and then you'll see the issue that's occurring here, which is the minimize and the maximize buttons are missing. And then when I actually try to close this application, there's a delay and it won't close, and then I get a prompt to force close the app, which
basically
is
crashing then on close, right, which isn't a good thing.
That's right. It's a super painful experience. So before I get into how we actually fix this, I want to show you something else that's really important here. So I'm going to click into the directory, and you can see that the directory includes a runtimes folder or directory with three installers that have to actually be installed in a very specific order in order for this application to run, which is not a great experience. So our team helped with this issue as well, and I'll cover off on that a little bit later. So now one thing we tell our customers to do before they spend countless hours or even weeks troubleshooting an issue is to try some of these built-in compatibility modes. Mm-hmm. And the way you pick a compatibility mode is you actually go back to when the application was actually developed and pick that compat mode.
Right.
So in this case, this application was built for XP. Our team actually did try to see if the Windows 7 compat mode would work for this app, but it didn't. So I'll show you what we ended up doing that did work. So if I go back into the Compat Admin tool, you can see here that we've created this custom SDB file and targeted the Windows XP SP3 compat mode to this particular EXE. Now you actually take one more step and you'll install this SDB, and then this will show up here in the installed database section. And now this should actually work. So we're gonna go back out and see what this actually did to the particular application that we had. So
okay,
I'm gonna launch this app again. So now you'll see the database error occur again. We'll ignore that. And then you can see that the minimize and maximize button have actually come up here correctly, and we'll be able to close it as well. Now, I mentioned earlier that the application actually had three installers, which is not the greatest experience on installation. And so what we did for this customer was we actually created a custom MSI file to improve that deployment experience. Mm-hmm. So I'm going to open that here and show you what that looks like. I'm going to actually load it in Orca. And you can see here that we've actually packaged each of the installers along with a shim that we applied. And then we wrote instructions to make sure that all of that was executed in the correct order. So now the customer can just take one single MSI, deploy it through their preferred management tool. In this case, it was ConfigMan. And then it's one step versus four separate steps that they would have had to take before.
All right, so it's a super good time saver to try out a compatibility mode. You can do that by right-clicking on an app as well to try it out. And you also repackaged, in that case, the MSI to make it super handy for anybody using a software distribution tool like SCCM to get that package out. But I want to do something a bit harder because we saw a compatibility mode. That's a fairly easy fix.
Yeah.
Why don't you show us something that was a bit more difficult to fix?
Yeah, for sure. So this is an application that wasn't fixed via simple compatibility mode. So after we verified that the application didn't actually work, we use something called Time Travel Tracer. Now, Time Travel Tracer is actually shipped with Windows SDK. So what TT Tracer does is that it captures event logs from an application. And so you can trace those events all the way through a failure and analyze them later in a debugging tool.
Right.
So what I'm actually going to do here is run Time Travel Tracer against our specific application, which is Contoso Tech Studio. And I'll enter the executable name here. And one thing that happens is that Time Travel Tracer, because it's capturing all the logs, it's actually going to slow down the application somewhat. So you'll see it'll take a few seconds to actually load the application in the background. There it is. I'll bring it forward, and I'm going to try to actually execute the function that we want, which is macro editor. And you get this less than helpful error. So now we have an export file that we can import into a debugger. So I'm going to use WinDBG, or that's what the team use, which is a common debugging tool that many people are familiar with. And I'll bring that up here. Now, the team, first thing they have to do is actually go to the exception that they find and then backtrack from there to a root cause. So in this case, you'll see here that .NET is loading a COM object that's trying to delay load a library. Contoso Text Library, tail merge, ICUUC, DLL.
It's kind of like your first clue now in this case.
That's right, exactly. So we kind of have an idea that there's something wrong with this particular file. And then the team had to find out the function that's being imported from the module. And in this case, our function is called Contoso API. It's this really ugly name. It's called the decorated name. There's another name for it, which is mangled name, and I think that's a lot more appropriate. Then we listed out and searched the functions in the export tables, but I'll skip that part for now. Finally, after a little investigation, we identified for sure that the issue was with the ICUUC library in System 32, and we'll talk about that a little bit later. Now, this is a library developed for international components for Unicode software. It turns out that the file that is shipped with Windows 10 is actually different from the file that was shipped back with XP.
Because it's probably like 20 years newer.
Exactly.
Yeah.
So the application is actually looking for something in the file that was shipped with XP that's no longer available in the Windows 10 file.
Got it.
So the fix for that is actually pretty easy. We track down the older version of the file, and I actually have it already copied here to the directory with the exe for the app. And I'm going to rename it here so the application can actually call it correctly. And then I'm going to launch the application, and you can see the function executes correctly. So like the previous example, we just packaged this application up and shipped it back to our customer, and they verified that it works correctly.
So you really outdid yourself in terms of the first one to this one. This was a harder fix, obviously. You can tell that your team obviously knows what they're doing. And it really covers the concerns that I think a lot of people have in terms of application compatibility, because even though it's only 0.16%, you might run into an issue like this, for example, and your team can really help. And these are really great examples of how you have already helped in terms of unblocking deployment. But what else are you hearing in terms of deployment blockers for people that want to move to Windows 10?
So Microsoft has done a lot of work connecting Windows and Office to cloud services. But to a lot of people, it might sound like that's the only way you can deploy. If you're concerned about moving to the cloud or attaching your endpoints to cloud services, my guidance to you is to start from where you are. If you're not ready to adopt cloud technologies like Intune, Azure AD, or Office 365 before your Windows 10 deployment, you don't need to.
Right, and this is something that you can always do later, and you can still upgrade completely on-premises using the tools that you have. You might be using Configuration Manager, and that said, not everybody has done a major OS deployment. So if you need help, is there anything that your team can do at FastTrack then to help?
For sure. So beyond the help we offer with Desktop App Assure through FastTrack, We also launched a FastTrack service that helps you upgrade to Windows 10 using SCCM. If you use SCCM now for software update management, the service shows you how you can get your deployment set up using in-place upgrade task sequences. And it helps you to automate as much as possible. If you're used to reimaging PCs as part of your OS deployment, you can feel good about automating in-place upgrades at scale using Configuration Manager. And a lot of organizations have used this for thousands of PCs. A good example is Hedrick Automotive Group, where they use in-place upgrade for their network of car dealerships across the Southeast US. Really now, in-place upgrade is the fastest way to move existing machines from Windows 7 to Windows 10. You don't need to worry about migrating user state or installing matching apps.
Right, this is great advice. Thanks, Aleks, and great tips. It's also great to see the work that your team's done, in this case, in the real expertise that's behind the service. Now, where can people that are watching this learn more and start engaging?
Great question. So we walked through the FastTrack portal earlier, and you can access information about Desktop App Assure at aka.ms/desktop-app-assure-request. Or if you'd like to learn about the Windows 10 deployment program, you can go to the FastTrack portal. The big thing that's super important to understand here is that these services are really just in place to help our customers move to Windows 10 and to deploy Office Pro Plus. We're not here to upsell you anything. There's no catches. We're really just here to help.
Great tips, and thanks again for joining us today, Aleks. Of course, keep watching Microsoft Mechanics. Hit subscribe if you haven't already, and we'll see you next time.